favorite part of the series, of course, because I've worked with these MFA students all semester, and they're a fantastic group, and I think you'll hear a variety of voices in their poems. As we're getting started, be sure to help yourself to some candy, because you'll like us better if you have sugar in your bloodstream. And there are also copies of TAB, the Journal of Poetry and Poetics. It's a journal, national journal, international journal, that we publish here at Chapman University. We do one print issue every January, and the other issues are online. And if you Google TAB Poetry Journal, it'll come up. But you're welcome to take a copy of that. There's some fantastic poetry in that journal. And the other thing I want to make sure to say is to turn off your cell phones so that they don't ring while we're reading poetry and distract us. The person introducing this evening's reading is the chair of the Department of English, Joanna Levin. And she's been a huge supporter of the series, and though we don't have Rice Krispie Treats this evening, she's the one who usually signs off on the Rice Krispie Treat order. She's also an expert in all things Bohemia. So, Joanna Levin.
Thank you, Hannah. I am delighted to welcome you all to the final Tabula Poetica event this semester, the MFA Poetry Reading. TAB, as you all, I'm sure, are well aware, with its brilliant, fearless leader, Anna Leahy, has thrived this past semester, both in the form of the lecture and reading series that concludes tonight, and also in the form of the innovative new publication, TAB, which Anna just mentioned and which you can pick up before you leave this evening. TAB, in all its forms, is really one of the prime energizing forces in our English department. And some of our MFA students, including some of who are going to be reading tonight, shared with me some reflections about what the opportunity to be part of TAB has meant to them. Students told me how much they valued having the chance to listen to and meet with such accomplished poets, including the likes of the great Pulitzer Prize-winning poet C.K. Williams. Noting, in the words of one student, that it was, quote, a great reaffirmation of the presence and importance of poetics today, end quote. Another student wrote that she loved every minute of the readings and appreciated that, quote, most poets were also translators, hence shedding a whole new light on the concept of literary citizenship. Yet all of them were trying to convey the feelings and thoughts of another nation to their English-speaking audience. And another student described how the diversity of poetic approaches featured in this reading series helps spur him to experiment with style, voice, and method. So we will be hearing very shortly from our MFA students. But first, we have the great pleasure of hearing Dr. Anna Leahy and Allison and her colleague Allison Bennis-White read from their own work. And if you want to read more of their work after hearing them read, their books, copies of their books are available for purchase. Constituents of Matter is available for $10, and same with Small Porcelain Head by Allison Bennis-White. And authors can accept cash or check, so that will be after the readings, if you want to experience more of their work. And our first reader is, of course, Anna Leahy, founder and director of Tabula Poetica, and she is directly responsible for making Chapman such a happening, vibrant place for the study and creation of poetry, and also for helping us better appreciate how poetry can enhance our grasp of other literary genres, and indeed other disciplines, including, quite notably in Anna's work, that of scientific inquiry. In a recent piece that was published in the Huffington Post, the writer Stephanie Vanderslice quite aptly refers to Anna Leahy as a quote-unquote connector. Vanderslice borrows this term from Malcolm Gladwell and uses it to describe someone whose, quote, uncanny ability to span many different worlds is a function of something intrinsic to their personality, some combination of curiosity, self-confidence, sociability, and energy, end quote. We are all so fortunate that Dr. Leahy has brought these qualities to Chapman and that she's helped all of us better to connect as readers, as writers, as literary citizens, and denizens of local watering holes, and Rudy's Diner, etc. Now, before this reading, Anna very modestly referred to herself as the warm-up band for tonight's rock stars, our terrific students, and also our colleague Allison Dennis White. But, of course, to quickly switch metaphors on you, Anna is herself a true poetic heavyweight. Her poetry collection, Constituents of Matter, won the Wick Poetry Prize, and you will see tonight that there is nothing oxymoronic about that phrase, poetic heavyweight, when applied to her work. Her poetry makes me feel, in the words of a line that I am proudly lifting from one of Anna's own poems, a, quote, shiver of warm-bloodedness. Her poems explore the intersections of space, time, matter, and the emotions that take shape in and between these ever-shifting forces. So momentarily, I will turn things over to Anna, but since I was identified as an expert in all things bohemia, and so I too can be part of this poetry reading experience, I'm going to leave you with a few lines from the poem In Bohemia, which was written in 1885 by one John Boyle O'Reilly. This poem actually became a really popular recitation piece, and it was a kind of ritualistic performative utterance that was used to unite all those kindred souls out there who sought to evoke and at least temporarily to inhabit a mythic utopian land of art, good fellowship, anti-materialism, and generosity of spirit. So here we go. In Bohemia, written by John Boyle O'Reilly and not the last by yours truly. I'd rather live in Bohemia than in any other land. For only there are the values true and the laurels gathered in all men's view. Bohemia has none but adopted sons, its limits where fancy's bright stream runs, its honors not garnered for thrift or trade, but for beauty and truth men's souls have made. To the empty heart and a jeweled breast, there is value, maybe, in a purchased crest, but the thirsty of soul soon learn to know the moistureless froth of the social show. The vulgar sham of the pompous feast, where the heaviest purse is the highest priest. Oh, I long for the glow of a kindly heart and the grasp of a friendly hand, and I'd rather live in Bohemia than any other land.
Which I hardly ever do. I hardly ever read publicly poems hot from the press, or not yet off the press. The first poem I'll read, I dedicate to my mother. And in the book Constituents of Matter, there's three sections, and each section has a poem in it that has the six names of quarks embedded in the poem. So how many of you know the six quark names? Those are the subatomic particles. All right, well, all of you who don't know, listen for those six names. See if you can figure them out. This poem begins with an epigraph by Henri Poincaré, and that epigraph reads, "Modern man has used cause and effect as ancient man used the gods to give order to the universe. This is not because it was the truest system, but because it was the most convenient. Moments, causes. Moments arrive like mothers, inevitably seamless and charming. History is thunder following lightning. Two moments from one cause, the seen and then the heard. Even the blind, when light is shown from a heatless, strangered distance, know the silent light's direction, up or down. They're there now. But wait, when out of time, out of place, one particular thing becomes another, unseemingly, the overlapping, like tops and bottoms of waves, that is metaphor. What are mothers for, if not to teach us to swim, by showing us the motions of arms and legs and planets, of flavors and colors, fathers and lovers, and holding our young bellies until we put our faces in the water with our breaths held. Water then is breathtaking, and we float suspended in we know not what until, knowing, we glide. The next poem is for a friend, a college friend, who died of brain cancer earlier this semester. He was diagnosed less than 2 years ago. So someone my age, someone who I hadn't seen in a long time, but had kept in touch with. And I'm still working on this poem, and I'm not sure exactly which direction it's going in, but the kind of cancer he had was glioblastoma. And so that's the title of the poem. And the shape of the cancer is like stars. So that's important as we go through the poem. Glioblastoma for Adam Schmitz. Astrocytes in the brain seem as numerous and shapely as stars in the universe. But when the stars in your brain go awry, they behave like dark energy, changing the shape of time. You see time's boundaries, constraints, get into your blood and bones, a double-barreled 2 years of choices to make on days you are able to make them. You're unglued and reglued in an instant, and everything's palliative after. That cloak of care is another kind of starlight, and it's all surgery and radiation by which you discern what's what. What had been an idea of happiness by which you tried to live becomes this moment and the next and the need to nap and weep, the want of words, the memory of magic that each friend bequeaths in your mind, however small, the need to father finitely and to love for all the time in the world.
That will be a little cheerier.
My colleague Jim Blaylock is there in one of the back rows. The reading is more crowded than I expected. Thank you all for coming out tonight. This is for Jim and Vicki Blaylock, and I realize now that my colleagues will not want to have conversations with me anymore, but this is based on a conversation earlier this semester. But that's the danger of hanging out with writers, right? We steal from each other all over the place. This is called The Fly. You know what it's about?
No.
Okay. The Fly. We saw a fly, he said, flying toward a woman's mouth as she bit into her sandwich. We raised our hands, he said, and parted our lips as if to speak, but the fly veered off. With the next bite, the same thing, fly buzzing toward the woman's open mouth, the almost gesturing to warn her, the insect darting away at the last second. The third time it happened, he said, we knew the fly did not want to glide into a gaping mouth, and so, he said, we did nothing. This time, the fly was the boy who cried wolf and flew into the woman's mouth. She did not distinguish fly from sandwich, he said now, and he said nothing then. Hearing this, I think that we all keep things about each other from each other. We play the day-to-day game of empathy, make our fly-by-night rules, accept a makeshift flight plan. next one is based on a conversation with Richard Bausch, who's sitting right in front of Jim Blaylock. This is actually based on a conversation at lunch with Richard Bausch, C.K. Williams, who visited here for the Tabula Poetica series this year, and my favorite Chapman University trustee, David Henley. You know what this is about now? It's called The Spider. Okay. All right, The Spider. The spider was as big as a cat, he said. The spider couldn't be crushed with a shoe. Some people keep these spiders as pets, he said. One woman wore her spider as a hat. A hat, he said, holding his hands, fingers spread like a spider above his own head. I wouldn't be afraid of a spider the size of a cat, I thought. Despite the fangs, the poison, the speed at which it moves on its haired legs, not even the tarantula has ever killed a person. Give a small spider 2 hours in the evening, the porch light on, and it will crochet a gorgeous web 4 foot square. Turning the porch light off last night, the web's gorgeousness was my thought, not the spider thinking. The spinnerets, we all have them, don't we? If I make something beautiful, I don't know it, not for certain, not for myself, never forever. And the last poem I'll read is the last poem in Constituents of Matter. And anyone figure out those 6 fork names? Anyone know the 6 fork names? Nobody. Oh, science education in this country. Okay, up, down, charm, strange, top, bottom. So the guys who discovered those first quarks and last quarks, not very creative, but charm and strange, that's pretty good for scientists naming quarks. So listen for those 6 words. The poem is called What Thoughts Are Worth. We all earn our thoughts by saving them, by placing their coppery existences on the rail that stretches to strange horizons. We wait, patient, for the train. And then a shadow of a profile lingers, like the shape of a fountain up slipping down. We perceive the thumb's laudable charm through the flat matter tingling our costly fingers. Some collect in a blue bowl on a waist-high shelf from the bottom of a pocket. Others rest atop eyelids like memories when the mind's inquiry mints itself. The gaze remains veritable. I slide one on my lavish tongue, suckle and glide. And now we'll move on to Allison Bennis White. She was a Tabula Poetica visiting poet in 2009. Since then, she's been teaching one of our undergraduate poetry workshops, I think every semester since then. So she made a great impression, and we're glad to have her back reading. Her most recent book, Small Porcelain Head, won the prestigious Levis Prize, and that's the one she has available for sale for just $10. And her earlier book, Self-Portrait with Crayon, won the Cleveland State University Poetry Center First Book Prize. I think they could shorten that title. Allison is a contemporary master of the prose poem. Her work is both narrative and lyric, both meditative and brash, both gorgeous and unsettling, and I think you're going to love it. Allison.
Thank you, Anna, and thank you guys for coming. I'm so excited to hear the MFA students read and to read with Anna, and just to be a part of the Chapman community. Every time I come to this campus, I thought it would fail. Months ago, and I've been reading from it, and still kind of struggling to figure out how to introduce the work. And a while ago, I was looking through my writer's notebook, and I found two quotes in a row. And when I read them, I thought, well, maybe reading these would be a good way to introduce the work. So the first is Jane Cooper, and she's talking about the poet and teacher Muriel Rukeyser. And she says, one of her favorite assignments was to ask everyone to complete the sentence, I could not tell. For in what we cannot say to anyone, in our most secret conflicts, lie curled, she believed, our inescapable poems. And the quote right below that is an Emily Dickinson quote from one of her letters to Thomas Higginson, and it's her birthday today. And so she writes to Higginson, I had a terror since September. I could tell to none, and so I sing, as the boy does by the burying ground, because I am afraid. So the reason I thought these quotes might be good to introduce this work, the reason they resonated with me is because these poems, I feel, as Rukeyser describes, they're my inescapable poems in that they come from my secret conflicts, what I feel I cannot say. And they also exist, as Dickinson writes, as a way to stave off fear near the graveyard as a response to a terror in September, she says. And strangely, the terror that I'm responding to in this book is my friend's suicide, and she actually died in September. So it's just a strange little coincidence, and part of the reason that I wrote that quote down, I think. So the poems in this book come from that polarity, kind of like a young child asking, where do babies come from? It's like when what you cannot say and what you must say love each other very, very much, a poem is conceived. And I think that, for me, is an accurate way to describe part of what's happening. So Small Porcelain Head, mainly it's a series of really short prose poems that are untitled, and they're mainly elegiac, like I said, in response to my friend's suicide. And they, what you'll find is that the speaker is engaging with these inanimate objects, these dolls, and with the suicide note as a way to try to create a language for, or a shape for, stillness, for grief, for bewilderment. Just what would otherwise be inarticulatable. So I'm going to read nine, which sounds like a lot, but they're very short, so we'll go very quickly. You won't feel anything. This is for Nicole. Can you hear me? It's always hard for me to tell if I'm speaking loudly enough. If pain is only weakness leaving the body, black curls still wet, painted on her forehead. If pain is a desire for dark shapes, even when dried, glistening, if you are reading this, what is left but obsession, handling the object over and over? My hands fit around her waist. Unbuttoning, I wanted nothing to happen or the same thing to happen forever in the same place. Although it is better, it is impossible to miss one thing, or when you go, to miss yourself. Soon the object must grow or become invisible, so familiar it is, so hollow you are inside. I have lost all hope for myself, she wrote, meaning there is one coat left which has failed. We have already undressed. Once I thought what could happen was only what I could imagine. Please forgive me. I pray and can't make it stop. There were lambswool wigs and paperweight eyes, two factory fires. Instead of blankness, I learned to draw stars with two triangles, one upside down and overlapping the other. I covered pages, then like bracelets, my wrists. that she has the right to turn the room inward, that when I speak, ashes flutter from my mouth, that her hands are drawn in lipstick on the mirror to firecrackers, that her hands are gone. I cannot go any further with my mind, that my mind is a hole when it flickers means bang. Even the violence is sentimental, limbs and head unstrung, not blood but wings, red butterfly, a glass box, a thousand pins, the end. Or clear red ovals lowered into a jar and coiled, a head on a neck made of rubies, a hive. God does not make sense, is never quiet. Buttoned together at their hips and shoulders and heads, when the cord is yanked, the cloth couple must dance violently, without the threat of consummation or injury, as death augments intimacy, ends the need for partitions, as they cannot get close enough to each other now, because they are not afraid, because there is no future. After our fingers, we put our mouths to the pain, a ceramic tongue broken off like chalk. As a child, I press my tongue to my wrist to see what it would be like to feel someone. What should I do with my mind? Think of the way it broke until the breaking is language. Pleasure to introduce our first MFA reader for the evening. I have her bio right here, which I will read. An Illinois native, Sarah Doyle graduated from Judson University with a BA in English and worked in law firms for the 7 years preceding an impromptu move to Bend, Oregon last year, where she met her now husband before beginning the MFA program at Chapman University. She enjoys literary criticism and theory and translated poetry and hopes to develop an English homeschool curriculum for junior high and high school grades. So please welcome Sarah Doyle.
As a non-native to California, I think any other transplants can relate to my panic of the I-5. This is California lightning bugs, the tourist version of passing through. The panic increased as the highway expanded into 5 lanes of freeway and I-5 opened up before me. Ramps from left merged with HOV, I don't even know what that means, while exits on the right tempt me to leave this chaos of lights whizzing by, motorcycles flying through lines of cars. The headlights of white my rear view blind and ignite annoyance, while yellow blinking signals make me think I'm missing something off to the sides. And the red blips of brakes ride each car in waves, battles of bobbing before one another, then weaving. Who knew lightning bugs to be so cruel while captured under a dome of sky, going nowhere at high speeds, quickly moving in and out of sequence without getting ahead? I wonder, how fast do lightning bugs blink, lit up with fear just before suffocating in a clear cage of mason jar? And if you live in California, it's really not that scary. So this is the resident version of California fireflies. Driving home at night, I glide the ramp down 55 to 5 and ease into a swarm of warm evening lights. The lower scope of traffic's back ends glowing on the right side of median movement. Blips and blinks against the dark outlines of exits to city life. Red brakes ahead lit up while weaving, a modern orchestra of silent performance for the skies. I like to write about other things than highways. So some of the poems I write are about the poetry of other things. And so this poem is about the cliches of poetry. rejection of it while simultaneously requiring it. The poetry of other things, not the heart or the brokenness of it, not the rain and the drying out afterward or smell of worms, not the tears cried at a funeral or a grave littered with bright fluttering flowers, not while sipping a latte and smoking cigarettes, not the permanence of pens across the pages of books, not the burning of books, not burning at all, fires, flames, sparks, and embers, to hell with it all. Neither the sweetness of new love couched between old loves and hand-me-down smiles served to others, nor jealousy or hell-raising, neither long drives through a winding countryside or across countries over skylines tracing constellations. Not the dark things, the hard things, the small things that creep into the crevices of your mind, the other things. My next poem is a true story about a woman named Katrina. Katrina. A woman went missing in October. Her car was found in a field where drops of rusty brown dappled the ground. A woman was still missing by November. No leads spurred police to the river. Once dredged, a body was discovered. A daughter's heart grew morbid in October. Her hope, morose by November. Young eyes that had brimmed with light auburn brightness, hardened, dull with learning, the worst of darkness. And end it on a happier note. My last poem pays homage to my home in Chicago. For anyone who hasn't been there, there's street performers who perform on the platforms of the L, and it's kind of fun to watch them as you go home from work. So this is Urban Beat. Electric guitar strums echo through a crowded tunnel station. I turn my head slight to see rhythmic black song man goatee, mouth wide with tune, his foot tapping time to hold the note above the fierce glaring grind of a train pulling. Graduated from San Francisco State University with a degree in creative writing. She is currently an MFA candidate here at Chapman University, and her creative work encompasses the individual experience and the truth of self. She is also the author of a blog, Who Needs Meat to Eat, and is self-proclaimed beach rat, and she wanted to write poems about her new baby kitten this summer, or this semester, but we told her she couldn't, so.
This one is about the Tenderloin. Tender wasteland. We curved the corner at Prosper and Suffering. The street ombre'd from gold to black shadow. The man in front of us wore high heels. The large gap from heel to shoe made him clunk down the pale gray street. Coarse blankets sprawled on concrete and signs that said, I will have to eat my kitten if I have no dinner. Wet residents in the alleyway. Cardboard roofs sagged like a soggy cigarette carton. We turned the corner on sorrow and bliss. I looked behind me and wished I could feed them with my poetry. Then we went home and counted our stars. Okay. This one is about the bay. It's called Crocodile. Today I thought about the last thing I was thinking about when I watched you kiss a baby like the president. Your cone-shaped nose jousted to the newborn's forehead. Your short stubbed arms and black eyes gestured to the crowd. Look at me, look at me. flaring your narcissistic nostrils. Now you sit waiting for the bay to blacken so that you can burn your teardrops and very important documents into the man-made fire. This one is called Escape. It's about a conversation that I heard on the bus, which is very common in San Francisco. Escape. Walking home, I say, I love walking home when it's raining. I like to pretend I'm a little boy and get wet like I don't care. You come back with, why not a little girl? In your room, I take off my shirt, my pants, my contacts, my face, my passion. In your bed, I ask, is it okay if I examine your testicles before we have sex? I've heard a lot about cancer today. You set your alarm and turn off the light. By your side, I think, is there a secret bird society that meets in lighthouses and plans attacks on little girls' fish and chips at the wharf? She wouldn't even put up a fight. She just threw them into the street. And then my last one is called Routine. Your clothes are laid out for you in the morning. Your shoes are laid out for you. Your desires are laid out for you. Like an animal scratching at its cage but will never puncture metal. Eyes like draining pools will be prodded until you cannot see how to be fulfilled. Wings will flow through your body and clog at each orifice. So, put your bones up for sale and hang your skin on the coat hook next to your muddy shoes to exhibit your shame. Eat your vegetables, dear. You need your vitamin C, D, E, L, M, N, O, P. Rest your feet up on eggshells and have a cup of all-natural herbal steep tea. Set your mask out for tomorrow and brush your teeth with H. Absin, because sooner or later, you will have to say goodnight. And then next, we have Brianna Henry. She earned her BA in Creative Writing and Religious Studies at the University of South Florida. She's new to California and writes eclectic and word-tastic poetry.
Soft, vulnerable, protected hearts. Hide. Wide, spread, thick bone curling in on itself, cupped palm, spread fingers, antler. Is it really the size of your piece that matters, rifle, or is it just the way you work it? Does experience count for anything useful, or could the young buck prove to be the best sack? Maybe it's all about the hunt, the sport, the chase. I don't know what else to say about that. It's the next one is a revelation of how we sleep in our bed. You lay on your side of the bed, and I'll lay on mine. We can meet in the mutual middle. Bodies hours ago, entranced, ravished, vanished, still pulsing for each other. Reproduction, a laughable sport. Here we are to please each other, to love each other, to know that we still have a life for another. You sink into your soft spot within breaths. I take half an hour to wriggle into mine, a position that will still result in pins and needles in my arm. I fidget uneasy. My restless sleep awakens you. A soft hand in mine ceases the tremors and twitches. Your stagnation brings me here, still, comfort, rest. You are my protector. You keep the monsters away. My nightlight is your glowing passion. I am strong, but the fables of night keep up my suspicion. You may grow up, but there are always unapprehended fears we have, many of which we will not admit to anyone, if we will even admit them to our own mind. This next poem was inspired by the cafe that is across the street from the little diner that we used to go to and get drunk before class in Florida. There is art at my local cafe, just hooks and wires hanging on the walls. Where is the lost call of found advertisement for the hand-drawn lines of people with elephant trunks for heads, flowers quietly that are not vaginas, phallic towers looming over, found art, painted trash, a plethora of mice skulls nailed through the eyes to a dilapidated boat oar. All of these are missing. Instead, there are hands curled around cups, genitalia as biology, mice living, rubbish receptacles, and recycling bins full. Art. And this last one is about my childhood. I don't really think there's much else to explain. Except it rains a lot in Florida all the time, and frogs come out in the rain. Rehoming feet. Golf cart rides down rolling, narrow streets. Milky large bucket sits between dangling feet, pacing the atmosphere with excitement. Blacktop glistening from fresh fallen rain. Constant perfection for hunting in this Florida town. Hopping spots move the land, quickened hands to embrace green joy. Slowly the bucket fills up, but you can never catch as many as you want. Sneaky little guys use one another for bigger jumps. One last pass around the now dark and quiet homes. Gentle tosses to let new friends find old, with the rehoming fee of old wives' tales leaking wort syrup to skinny elbows. Thank you. She earned her BA in Literature and her MA in Teaching and Linguistics at the University of Tehran. She's an MFA candidate and in Creative Writing at Chapman, and she has a passion for poetry, fiction, and the color pink. And if you make fun of her accent, I will beat you up. And I'm also part of her first
when it's called We the Common Folk.
Something in the world ain't right.
Not for
those who got money, where the common folk just toil and toil and toil all day long.
And all night, too.
And nights, too, indeed.
Something in the world ain't right.
Something in the world is wrong. We worry over a house, a loan, a job at stake. We have a night full of nightmares, and then we wake.
To all that's real.
Real to us, the common folk, not the rich.
They got their own wounds to heal.
Yeah, wounds like where to go this year, Madrid, or the Canaries.
Oh, happy us, the common folk. We got one of everything. The choice has been long made for us.
Something in the world ain't right.
Not for us, the common folk.
For the rich.
Aye, for the rich.
My next poem is made up of two parts. So in the first part, a bunch of questions are posed, and in the second, the answers are given. Fairyland. Fairies of the lands forlorn. Lands whose beasts and magic things never cry and neither mourn. Do tell me your stories. Is the magic crystal shoe still fit for Cinderella's foot? Does the beauty with her beast live in the same dark lonely woods? What has now become of the little mermaid of seven seas? Does she live with her lover and sunbathe on the sand with ease? Tell me, fair and fine fairies, tell me of your Snow White. Was she saved with that one kiss, or is this still the same sad sight? Does Alice still wander in confusing mazes of Wonderland? Did she paint the roses red in green gardens that were so grand? For me, if you want to know, it's neither magic, nor curse, nor vice. I don't need the magic shoe, nor the kiss of love, nor dice. All I want of fairyland are velvet wings I could expand. In our land of mysteries lie thousands of stories. There are some we cannot tell, but some we're willing to share. The magic shoe you asked about perfectly fits her left foot, but she now has shoes of her own. Her dresses are no longer worn. She has a daughter, and last week, her red-cheeked baby boy was born. Poor Ariel, she never had a chance to go visit her dad. The old Mer King died in regret. Why did I give her up? He said. The little mermaid's now a queen, the finest that kingdom has seen. Too bad her husband, now the king, is cheating on her. That's the thing. Snow White, so fine and fair, with her red lips and her black hair, she never opened up her eyes. Her body in that coffin lies. Her prince now, when he saw her dead, took off his hat, kneeled at her bed, and cried until he died. Their love story thus spread. And we all said, from the skies above, now that is what you might call love. Thank you. So, please join me in welcoming my dear friend and colleague, Mr. David Crossman, Southern California native. David is currently working on both his MA in English and MFA in creative writing here at Chapman. His interest lies in the intersections and interconnections of life with fiction and the exploration of one's textual identity. David Crossman.
Okay. A little taller than Brianna and Roja. As the last poet, I just want to thank you all again for coming. We really appreciate it. Knowing that people care about our poems. My first poem I wrote when I was an undergraduate, it's called Why a Locket is Called a Locket. Crossing the courtyard, something caught my eye. Though by no means an unusual occurrence, this time I paused to glance at the glinting gold that flashed, flickered, and rolled repetitively round your neck. What a lovely locket. It's not, hand gliding down, daintily sliding round, grasping until the catch was found. It gave a little pressure and split the heart in two, splaying before me. I could see all that heart had come to be. On one side, a well of thick lip balm, and the other, a round. My next poem is called The Pragmatics of Orology. I found out this orology is the study of how we measure time. So like when your mom's like, one more cigarette, and you're like, how long is that? She's actually being an orologist. And it starts with an epigraph from Seth Michelson, who was a visiting poet of Tabula Poetica. Quote, "So what use is it to study, to work, to play piano, when always you're at least ankle deep in time's cold ocean?" So this is The Pragmatics of Orology. Joshua keeps a poor old pocket watch on the side opposite his wristwatch. The pocket watch is old. Not grandfather checked it storming Normandy old, not respectably old, but the kind of old, nasty old something acquires, like old car tires. That rubber that can't be burned or turned into anything. It doesn't do anything once it's been used. It just sits forever, and there's just so little one can do with it, and even less it can do for us. It's sad how the pocket watch cannot compete with design and style so neat of its wristwatch counterpiece that tells not just the time, but can tell multiple times and figures on a dime. But the pocket watch must mean something to Joshua, whatever meaning something to Joshua means, whatever a disrespectfully poor old pocket watch can mean to Joshua, whatever meaning something to Joshua means. But his wristwatch can tell you the weather, can tell you who won the game last night, whether the play was a flop or if there was applause nonstop. I hear it'll even check your pulse to tell you if you're well. It'll tell you if you should fix your car or tell you if you should sell. I want to watch like Joshua's wristwatch. This next poem starts with an epigraph as well. You may recognize it. "If a man also lie with mankind as he lieth with a woman, both of them have committed an abomination. They shall surely be put to death. Their blood shall be upon them." The poem is called, "Which one of you is the woman?" "In bed, I half wake, and seek comfort in your embrace, sliding between those arms I love and snuggling close. That makes me the woman," they'd say. "Though when morning comes, and you're fretting, flustered, finding the perfect tie, and spend half an hour searching just for a tie, ha! They'd say, you're the woman." "But I make you lunch, and when I can't get the lid off the jelly jar, having to ask you to do it, they'd say, I'm the woman, again. On the other hand, at work you hold your tongue for ripping off the heads of co-workers that nibble at your sanity, despite being their boss, you stay quiet. They'd say exactly like a woman would. Yet, I'm home for the day, cleaning up the house, doing laundry, and washing dishes so we don't have to, and can enjoy date night without piled up dishes to greet us back. So they'd say I'm the woman. But you drive defensively. Some would even say poorly. Hey, woman. Though soon enough, my toes are excitedly on their tips, my hand wrapped softly around that perfect necktie, kissing you a hello, my darling. And they definitely say I'm the woman there. I pay for dinner, so that makes you my woman, they'd say. But you held the door open for me. Can you believe they'd say that makes me the woman? Hand-holding, little cuddling, some damp eyes during the movie. I know they'd say someone was the woman during the movie, but the interchanging too indistinguishable in the low light for me to tell. When we're home, in bed, laughing, our stomachs too full, our bodies too tired for sex, my head hurts, my back hurts. Are we both the woman? They'd probably say yes. Though, if so, if tenderness, if goodwill, if concern, if courtesy, if consideration, if thoughtfulness, if grace, if heart, if makes, if marks the woman, who would ever want to be a man? My last poem is from an upcoming project, and it's taking Craigslist personal ads and putting them into poems. And it sounds silly, but the sort of thought behind it is, where will we go to find that connection in our communities? So this is one of the much more tamer ones, called Genuinely Seeking Real Love 36. I'm searching for that one man with whom I can spend the rest of my life, that we can call each other our own, someone to wake up to every morning and smile. Romance is not dead. It just may be a little further away. I'm kind, considerate, caring, and genuine. That's what I want in return. A man who knows himself, is comfortable with who he is, between 35 and 45. Currently living in Ireland, and not against moving to be with the right man. That's how serious I am. I'm not interested in hooking up for fun. I want a long-term relationship / marriage, the whole nine yards. I hope you do too. I'm no Cinderella, but I hope my Prince Charming finds me. If Mr. Wright is reading this, get in touch. Thank you.
Exam you've ever been to? I just want to say that it looks like this is such a great series that our opener, Maureen Alsop, came to hear the final reading of the series. So it's been a great time, start to finish. I want to thank everyone who attended the readings, even if this is your first one. I hope you keep coming back to readings on campus, both Tabula Poetica and the Fowl Center. And I just want to finish up with one big round of applause for the five MFA poets who read tonight.